Well, hello and welcome to After the Sermon, a podcast that we do here at Bethany for the purpose of diving deeper into Sunday messages, for the purpose of application, and just wrestling through those hard topics that we may have. Pastor David Baxley will be doing our sermon on Sunday, and so I'm joined with him, and also I'm joined with Bill Leonardson. I am thrilled that you're here. He is a nominee to be one of our elders, and we are going to approve that coming December 5th, I believe, is the date for that. So we are glad that you're here with us. I'm excited for people to get to know you a little better.
Thank you. So
we are starting a new, and I'm Tammy DeLau. I should say that also. but we are starting a new series we did last week. It's going to be 27 weeks in the book of John.
27. So, I feel like whenever we say 27
weeks. We want to scare you.
Yeah, I want to really say one of the beautiful things that we've seen as we've been looking at the book of John is Josh Walker actually worded it this way, and I appreciate it. It's almost like there's different seasons represented, and so we're going to be breaking it down a little bit, because I do think different as the story's unfolding, there's very unique seasons within this book. So if you have a full, a mini series, you might say, there's these little seasons that we might have within it that I think are going to help guide that and keep it fresh and real for us.
Well, I'm excited. Just last week you shared with us that God was revealing Jesus as not only God, but also creator. And this week we're going to look at how man reveals Jesus. So that's kind of your topic, correct?
Yeah. I think that is the right summary. Yeah. Mm-hmm. If last week we were looking at how God is revealing Jesus to us and all those descriptions. Mm-hmm. Now we could see how God reveals Jesus to others through us. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think I said how we reveal Jesus, but really it's God is revealing Jesus through his word. So God's doing the work. And I think that's important as we get into this message a little bit, why we need to keep reminding ourselves of that truth, but it's God revealing Jesus through us. And we're starting in the second part of chapter one, verses 19 through 51 here. And this is where we move out of this like poetic narrative of the prologue of John. And we're moving to now, we're actually getting to what we often see in the story, our gospels, more of a story. Mm-hmm. What's going on in the life of like real people that are beginning to walk and live and experience life with Jesus and the things around them. And so we're emphasizing really the story of John the Baptist here. And Bill, you made a good point earlier that John is in all of the gospels. And we get a piece of him in all the gospels. Yeah. And I was looking back at some of those as well. One of the things in the Grow Group questions, I'd love for them to look at some of those other stories and just to get a better feel of who John was, what was happening, even the baptism of Jesus and those type of things. But for us, if you guys were even to comment, what do you think that is lacking in John here that it would be important for people to know about John? That we're not able to hit in the message, or that is that John the Apostle, as he's writing this, that what is he not telling us about John the Baptist that is cool for people to know as they get into this a little bit more in their grow groups?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, if you look at the four Gospels, it's in there. That story is repeated in all four Gospels. John writes it very concisely, very unemotional. This is just, it's kind of like the old show Dragnet. Just the facts, ma'am.
Oh, my goodness. And,
there it is. I just dated myself terribly.
You did. Oh, my goodness. That's going to be an
analog. I didn't do it.
But it's tightly written. It's concise. Mm-hmm. And if you look at the other three Gospels, Mark, it's the first chapter.
Yeah.
And not so much about what I think about. It's not so much the man, John, that I think people will maybe get a better sense of the man John the Baptist by looking at the other Gospels. Mm-hmm. But in the other Gospels, you have some very strong indications about the impact that he was having on the culture of the time and the population. And they were, there was a breadth to his ministry and people were coming. And so, right away you ask the question, what was so compelling about that message? So I think that's a question that you're going to have in your mind when you read the other three Gospels.
Mm-hmm. And I think we don't get you'd love to hear what all these different sermons were, in the sense we get all these messages that Jesus brought in various forms. We don't get we get this idea of what John was preaching more as the summary. I went to Mark just as we were talking here and, again, coming back to, and John came baptizing in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And then the next phrase, which you alluded to, the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him. The masses were coming out to him.
Yeah, the whole.
And they weren't just coming out listening. And then it says, and they were baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. Mm-hmm. And that's a great summary, I think, if you want to know the ministry of John the Baptist right there.
You had shared something, Bill, about hope that I thought was beautiful. And so what were we talking about before?
Well, just I think if you consider the context of the time, I mean, this is the way it impacts me. If you consider the context of the time, they're an oppressed people. Mm-hmm. They're living under Roman control. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So John the Baptist's message is about repentance and forgiveness, confessing and forgiveness of sins.
Restoration to God.
Restoration. But the people were also hoping for a Messiah in the midst of this too. So, you know, at the beginning when it said, make straight the way of the Lord. And so the way I look at that is that John is saying, Christ is coming. Mm-hmm. You need to clean up your lives. They believed Christ was coming. They were hoping and praying that Christ would come because they wanted him to come on a horse with a sword.
Right.
So,
and take care of the enemies.
But their John's message was get right because Christ is coming.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that takes us to where we started we're going to start the message in the verse 19, because the religious leaders, the priests, the Levites, they come and they're asking John, who are you? Because that's what's in their mind. And you've set the stage for that beautifully right there. Mm-hmm. They're like, something's happening. There's a message getting preached. Right. This looks like a pretty big deal. The crowds are all riled up. Mm-hmm. Are you the Messiah? Are you Elijah? Are you who are you?
Well, and I'm even thinking, just because we're studying Exodus, when they do their Passover, when they're thinking of deliverance, they saw their people and the stories they're telling, the Egyptians were killed, their enemies were taken care of. So they're probably looking for more of the same at some level. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I mean, that's kind of the story they're used to.
And Bill, you alluded this to earlier when we were chatting too, is that as the people were coming with hope, some of these coming right now in this story are more the skeptics. Some of them, you know, maybe sincerely coming and asking, who are you and what? But we know, as we see what takes place in the other gospels, these priests and Levites were key figures that were coming and saying, we don't like what's happening. Someone else seems to be getting all the attention. Someone else has taken the people out of listening to us, and they're coming to the river and listening
John's
to you.
John's stealing their thunder.
Yeah, that's exactly right. He's stealing the thunder. And so, and he's like, well, just so you know, I'm not the Messiah, right? Mm-hmm. That's the setup. And I think if there was this beautiful summary for me of John, and we could get into all the things he says he's not, all of that, but just how John so sincerely deflects any praise to himself because of who he wants them to start to see. That to me, I spoke to this, and I'll speak to this in the message a little bit, but
that would be a great girl group question. Are we willing to deflect being seen for the Lord to be seen?
And what does that look
even
like?
Even for somebody else to take the credit and not.
Because it's not as direct as, are you the Messiah? Mm-hmm. No one's coming to any of us and saying, wait a minute, are you Jesus? Mm-hmm. Are you God? Mm-hmm. But I think we live in a culture that desperately wants to see somebody be someone they can fully rely on. Mm-hmm. They want someone to be the representation.
Well, that's
hope.
What the people wanted with Christ.
Yes.
They wanted their Messiah. They wanted him to come. To me, you know, I think of the old saying about, be careful what you wish for. Mm. I mean, they've been praying for a savior. Mm-hmm. They've been praying for a Messiah. Mm-hmm. They wanted a warrior Messiah. Mm-hmm. But it's like, oh, we've been praying for this and praying for this, and now John's got this message. I need to come and get right, because I've been praying for this, and now I think it's happening.
Mm-hmm. And it wouldn't surprise me if there were people that were, if the crowd's coming and watching, the masses are going back and talking, and they were like, hey, is the Messiah here?
Yeah.
That they were wondering if it was happening now, if this was the guy. Mm-hmm. And how John beautifully says, I'm not the guy, but let me tell you about the guy. Mm-hmm. But I mentioned this in the message, and I just want to hit this in here, because for grow groups, and maybe there are people that heard this and didn't realize this, this is one of the reasons why, as a church, we believe so much in a preaching team. Mm-hmm. Why we believe in not having one person be the figurehead of all teaching and all and all speaking and all of those type of things, because what we instinctively do, and I know I even do this, and we've walked this a little bit as a church, and just even recently, we lift people up. Mm-hmm. Even if they're telling us about Jesus, we still tend to lift them up because I don't see Jesus right now. Like it's just that physical need mm-hmm. versus that spiritual. And we lift people up. And the truth is we're going to fail. Mm-hmm. We're going to fall. Mm-hmm. We're seeing so many casualties in the Church of America right now because of how much we listed the celebrity of the pastor. Mm-hmm. Small church, big church, doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. We lift up the celebrity of the pastor or even the celebrity of this preacher mm-hmm. instead of the celebrity of the one we're preaching about. Mm-hmm. Because when the preacher falls, the one we were preaching about hasn't changed.
No.
But yet there's devastation, mm-hmm. people leaving churches and not returning mm-hmm. because of the preacher. And that's the heart I would want people to see in what John the Baptist was doing is so as much to his ability. Don't look to the preacher. Look to the one I'm preaching about. Mm-hmm. Don't put your hope in me.
Yeah.
Anyways, that's a big piece and why we do what we do here at Bethany the way we do it.
Mm-hmm. So we have our girl groups maybe go through looking and seeing John and his birth to these old people and we'll do that kind of stuff because mm-hmm. I think there's some that probably don't even know who John the Baptist was.
Or, yep, we'll do
his
that.
His relation to Jesus. So,
and then curious if to even discuss. I'd be curious because the idea of rotating preachers is not normative for everybody. Mm-hmm. It's something we do. It's something other larger churches are starting to do more and more of. Mm-hmm. But if you came from a small church, you probably only had one option. Mm-hmm. But how does what John's doing encouraging us to remember how not to lift people up mm-hmm. and why is it that we tend to lift people up and how can we even our own church mm-hmm. Bethany remember to not lift any person up mm-hmm. but continue to see Jesus as we all together are lifting Jesus up?
For some of us for this country I think it's partly cultural. We celebrate the leader.
Okay. Yeah.
We worship
that's a
the
good
leader.
Word.
We,
that's a good word.
The person who exceeds and excels. And so we.
Oh, that's good. Bring that.
You know, coming out of business, you know, you always talk about the heroic manager. Mm-hmm. Well, if the business you're working in or for, if they're smart, they try to get you to not do that because you get to a point in your career. You can't control everything. You know, in the idea of servant leadership, which we've heard a lot about for mm-hmm. what the last 10 years, I suppose. Yeah.
Well, I mean, as you're talking, Bill, I'm thinking about how do you guys remember as a child playing follow the leader? I mean, we're taught.
Oh my goodness. Those are beautiful pictures both you guys are doing right there. Those are great.
That
yes.
Played have set us up to believe that is the right way.
Right. Mm-hmm. Rather than the servant leader, or mm-hmm. the humble leader, or the. Mm-hmm.
Right. But even then, there may be someone, and we talked about this a couple weeks ago in the message about elders and pastors and all mm-hmm. of that, and deacons. Mm-hmm. We want to follow our leadership because our leadership is pointing us to Jesus. Mm-hmm. And where our hope has to be mm-hmm. is in Jesus.
Yeah.
So when a leader misses, which will happen because mm-hmm. we're not infallible, mm-hmm. when a leader even falls or even leaves, mm-hmm. where our hope isn't shifted. Because that leader and all of us together as a church kept looking to the Lamb of God. Mm-hmm. He's the one that takes away the sins of the world. And that's what John was doing, because that's what he does. He redirects mm-hmm. people. Mm-hmm. And then he says, now look, mm-hmm. the Lamb of God mm-hmm. who mm-hmm. takes away the sins of the world. Don't see me. I'm not the Messiah. Mm-hmm. I'm not any of these great things. I mentioned this in the message. I'm actually in the same place all of you are mm-hmm. in desperate need, completely unworthy to even untie his sandals. Mm-hmm. Look, I want you to see the Lamb right. of God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which was the job of a slave. Mm-hmm. And John's saying, I'm not even
worthy to do that.
I'm not even worthy to be his slave.
Oh, that's a good, mm-hmm. that's a good connection. And so mm-hmm. I know we could easily spend a lot of time mm-hmm. even on Lamb of God.
I know,
and,
I want to go to
and
Lamb
I know
God
you do,
so
and
bad.
Passover and those things. And we're gonna do a little bit with that next week. Okay. So I'm putting a pin in on purpose because okay. Wade Moses is okay. bringing up is keeping us going Wade. And to go to that mm-hmm. And the beautiful gospel message in that, mm-hmm. but. If we focus on kind of more on John's example in this one, as we kind of go to that next section, we look at how John begins. It says this in verse 32, and I love this. I grew up in the South, and the word testify was one that we would do. Like, who wants to stand and testify what Jesus has done? Hallelujah, right? And in verse 32, at least in the CSB, it says, and John testified. Mm-hmm. I saw the Spirit descending to heaven like a dove and rested on him, and I didn't know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water told me, the one you see the Spirit descending on and resting on, he is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And so John testifies and he says, listen, this is what I've seen. Mm-hmm. This is how I know this is the Lamb of God. This is how I know this is the one who takes away the sin of the world. And how he does it is a point in the message I'd like to spend a little time on, because I'm going to talk about how he doesn't point to human evidence and human logic. Mm. He points to the supernatural evidence. Mm-hmm. The supernatural logic, and we talked about this in Preaching Bill. Let's be honest, we say the word supernatural, we kind of freak out a little bit, like, and mm-hmm. you even said that coming in a little bit, Bill. You wrestled with that word.
Yeah, it's an edgy. I think it's an edgy word.
Edgy word. That's right. That's how you said that.
And you know, and I like to think of it when you think of supernatural. I like to think that God is not constrained, he's not confined, and he's not defined by natural law. That's right. He operates outside natural law. Mm-hmm. Well, the term we have for that is supernatural. Yes. But when we start thinking about supernatural, then we start thinking about voodoo and black magic.
Yeah.
And it's not, we don't mean that, mm-hmm. but it's just what goes on in our head.
Yeah. So then do you think that's why we may be quiet and not as bold as John, is because we're afraid people are going to think, nah, 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 if you start sharing stories that really don't make sense, you know?
That's one thing that I think Western culture has taught us is to value Billy said this earlier, what we can see, what we can touch, what we can prove.
Mm-hmm. That science, we value.
Yeah, like one of the things that modernism did is modernism brought in this narrative into Christianity that everything should be provable. Mm-hmm. Everything should be able to prove and know the answer to every question without a doubt. And you can prove that that's the right answer. And that's the gospel. Mm-hmm. And in that, I think what we did is we lost. The fact is that actually the beauty of the gospel is that it is not in our standards, mm-hmm. in our minds, something that is just so easily known, so easily provable, mm-hmm. and not so easily replicated. And I think by supernatural, this is how I would word it. It is the evidence of God doing what only God can do.
Mm-hmm. That's good. Mm-hmm. That's good.
That is good. That's a good definition.
And so what John is doing, he's pointing to what his supernatural experience was, what he saw that supernaturally
like
happened.
Like a dove descending.
Yeah. And so I asked this question. I'm going to ask this question. And I think this, if the grow groups could hang out on this for a little bit, I would love to, because I'd love to hear you guys speak to this is, why are we, and you started to allude to this, why are we afraid to talk about the supernatural? And what are the things that maybe we don't even realize are the supernatural things that God has done in our lives? Mm-hmm. Like the very first one is salvation. Mm-hmm. Salvation is a supernatural event. Mm-hmm. And there's evidence of it, but I can't really prove to you, like, but what I can do is I can testify mm-hmm. of what I once was mm-hmm. and am now. What I once was and am now even doing in my life, not just the moment of salvation, but how God is continually working. These are tests. That's how we testify to the supernatural work of God.
And this is for the same reason that leadership can be hard for us, because we played King of the Mountain, our mm-hmm. follow the leader. Is supernatural hard for us? I think of being a little girl at slumber parties and light as a feather, stiff as a board. I mean, those weird things that children do that are not right. Does that make, and so is that part of it? Some of the supernatural things we experienced were not of the Lord. Does that make sense at all?
That's an interesting thought. I didn't even consider that. Mm-hmm. Do you have a thought on that, Bill?
Like, I'm no, just curious. Just being a good listener right now.
Yeah, no, that's an interesting thought, Tammy, is, well, and even if they aren't real experiences, I think you're right. I didn't say this in the message, but this is maybe good for this podcast, is I think one of the reasons we get afraid of this topic is because we are afraid of the fake. Mm-hmm. We're so afraid of being fooled. Mm-hmm. We're so afraid of something. What we often talk about, even in the Christian world sometimes, we don't talk about the... We didn't talk about the fakes more than the real. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you pick up on that, but we talk about the critics instead of what God is really doing. Mm-hmm. And there's a reason why even the enemy replicates mm-hmm. false, mm-hmm. because God is on the move in the real. Mm-hmm. And I think we give the enemy a win when we emphasize what has been done that is false, instead of telling people more and more about what God is doing that is real. Mm-hmm. And the truth is, the real is the unexplainable works of God in our lives.
I was going to say, it doesn't seem realistic.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The real does not seem realistic. Mm-hmm. And I've witnessed to my family, and then we talk about shying away from the supernatural, but I've shared Christ with a couple of members in my family, and I did talk specifically about that, not in great detail, again, because I was uncomfortable going there.
Yeah, right. But I understand.
In sharing Christ, there's elements of that that they did not understand, probably because I didn't do a good job of articulating it, you know. But where I ended up having to go, because they wanted to ground the experience with Christ in the see, feel, and touch
arena.
And I had to go there and say, but this you can't explain all this, you know.
So now I feel I'm kind of putting you on the spot, but I would be curious what it was that you were trying to share with them that felt supernatural. That does that make sense? And are you willing to do that?
Well, I'm willing to do that. I'm trying to figure out how to articulate that. Because I mean, as soon as you start talking about the Holy Spirit and talking about a faith in Christ, and to me, that's all in the eyes of the world, that's all supernatural.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, coming to Christ that transforms our heart, transforms our life, transforms our behavior, transforms the way we think. That's all supernatural.
Right.
Because we're doing it. I would have loved to have been doing this last week when you were talking about blind faith. Because we had a great conversation last night about blind
faith. That's great.
But there is an element there that you just have to trust.
And when you spoke to testimony, I'm like, man, in a court of law, if two or three people have evidence that wins.
Eyewitness evidence. Yeah. I can testify. Yeah. I have seen.
Right.
And I have heard. Mm-hmm. And I believe because I saw it and they saw it and they saw it. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's so good, Tammy.
And so when we choose to be quiet, we are not giving we're not building the case for Christ in the same way. So I'll share one that just, I have a dear friend whose husband was dying, and I knew he was dying, and I was downstairs in the lobby with her grandchildren taking care of them. And everything within me was like, get to Jane, urge to get to Jane. And I didn't know why. And her daughter came down and I'm like, is anybody with your mom? And she said, no. And I said, may I go up there? And it was just like I have never felt get somewhere, like that fast. And I ran in, and Jane looks at me with her beautiful brown eyes, and she goes, Tammy, John's dying. And I'm like, I know, Jane, because I thought she was just so devastated. Like she forgot that I was part of, the equation and I had heard that morning. And she's like, no, he's dying right now. Hold me. And it was like the Holy Spirit just propelled me to Jane. Does that mean like that? Yeah, I can't explain that. Mm-hmm. Now, I've had a couple situations in my life where I knew that I knew what I was supposed to do. I want every day to be like that. Sometimes I wonder if the voices of our world drowned us out.
God,
but yeah, like that is supernatural. Like that was the Holy Spirit saying, get to Jane. That testifies to the power of who the Holy Spirit is and God's love for my friend, that he gave her physical arms to hold her when her husband breathed his last. So, but we don't often share those kind of stories because it sounds so, bizarre. So...
Well, and even as we say that, I was thinking, as you say this, and Bill, what you said before, I was reminded of what Paul says to the world. The cross is what? Foolish.
Foolish.
Mm-hmm. It's foolish. Mm-hmm. Truly, because we have a world that really denies the aspect of supernatural, when we speak of supernatural, they think, and we know it, that's foolishness. Mm-hmm. You guys are just fools. Mm-hmm. You're fools to believe that. Mm-hmm. You're fools to think that. You're fools to think that there was somehow some supernatural thing doing that in your life. You just knew your friend would be hurting. They challenge that and they call us fools. And we stand and think, well, if they're going to call us fools, I shouldn't share it. It's going to hurt the gospel. Mm-hmm. But Paul says the very foundation of Jesus' sins, cross, resurrection, will be foolish to those that have not experienced. Just because it sounds foolish and stop us from testifying. Mm-hmm. We got to keep testifying no matter how, because the Spirit's at work through that testimony to show them the supernatural power of God.
Mm-hmm. Well, our Yeah, when you think about it, as you're talking, you know, our faith rests. Mm-hmm. I mean, our existence as believers rests on the resurrection.
There you go, right there.
Is there anything more supernatural than the resurrection? And without that, you know, it's without that, our faith is, I don't know, I get in trouble here, but it's hollow.
No, it is.
We rest on the idea that Christ was raised from the dead. That's supernatural.
And so just because I know we got like less than not even 10 minutes right now. So I'm like moving us along. But this was really helpful. This was the conversation I was hoping to have. Grow group leaders, feel free to echo some of this. Even if you feel like, hey, this is kind of a weird word. David said this thing. People maybe freaked out a little bit. Go over this part of the podcast. Bring it up on the TV for a minute if it helps facilitate discussion. Because what we don't want to do is, yes, I understand. Like we even said it before the podcast, we talked about the preaching team. Oh, once we say that word, it kind of freaks people out. But let's bring back truth. Mm-hmm. Let's bring back why with this is for believers. We don't want it to freak us out. We want to actually tell people more and more about Jesus's and begin to own that without fear, but with confidence.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I know one of the pushbacks that you received on preaching team was, you know, you start sharing these stories. Someone is healed from this illness, or I magically got this wonderful vehicle that it can spur people on to thinking, well, where's my healing?
Yeah.
Where's my van? Where's my check in the mail to prove that God loves me? And that's good. I loved your pushback on that, because I think sometimes I am guilty of not sharing those stories or to a select few, because I don't want to hurt someone else, or because I know I have a friend whose husband died. So the miracle doesn't always happen. The supernatural healing doesn't always happen. And I loved your response to me when I pushed back on you. So I'd love to, because I know as people are doing this and they're going to share.
You want to share what are you wanting me to share?
I want to know what the response is.
I want you to share what you, because it was a good challenge. I felt very challenged.
I want to make sure I'm afraid to articulate it wrong now. I'm trying to think through that a little bit. But if I remember back to that conversation, I think the challenge is let's not rob telling people the greatness that God has done, but instead when we start to say, well, where's mine, begin to deal with, and why am I hurting?
Jealous.
Yeah. Why am I jealous? Why am I upset? And then also I would come back and say, but you actually probably have your story. Mm-hmm. You just forgot it. Mm-hmm. And we all have, for a believer, we all have a supernatural story.
Right.
We have salvation. Mm-hmm. Now, I, without a doubt, with complete confidence, will say that is not your only story. Mm-hmm. But we maybe forgot to see the supernatural work in our God. And so when I say, well, why hasn't God done something like that for me? Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, he's done something like that for you. Mm-hmm. Why have you forgotten?
Right.
Or maybe you have to say, God, show me where I saw you working, because I missed it. And I'm sorry I missed it. Because to say you don't do those things for me, what, to deny the goodness and work of God that we see echo throughout the Gospels, echo throughout Scripture, even Old and New Testament, how God shows up. Mm-hmm. And instead, let's ask the Spirit to remind us of those of those things, instead of saying, well, I can't talk about that because not everyone's had that.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's great. And I think you even went a tiny bit further, even as we're studying in Exodus, when things are good, it's easy to praise the Lord. But when things are hard and you're pressed in, you see what's really in your heart. Mm. And there's grace in that when we see what's in our heart. And so if you share something with me and I'm like, well, why didn't someone do that for me? I get to see my ugliness and my jealousy and my not love for you. And that's a gift. And so does that make
doesn't
sense?
It feel like a gift.
It doesn't, but does that make sense? Like a gift, and but so I felt very challenged, because I do think there's a part of me that does hold back some of those things because I don't like the, well, where's mine? And I've seen, I know there's also hard. And so I want to care for my brothers and sisters, that if you say, my mom was healed from cancer and my mom died from cancer, God is still God, and how to reconcile. Does that make sense?
It's hard. You're hitting the thing, though, that I think also we see done wrong, which we resist sometimes, and that is that people don't do it pointing it to God. Mm-hmm. Like they tell stories about God, but they're doing it for themselves.
For the building.
Yeah, for the building of themselves and get intention. Well, there's two things to that. One is that's a legitimate concern. There are people that are trying to rob glory from God. And that is. But yes, I also think of the words of Paul in Philippians when he says, even when the gospel is preached with impure motives, I still rejoice because the gospel's preached.
Because the gospel's
Because the gospel's preached. You know, and like I can look and say, I do not like the way that person's doing it. And Paul can say, yep, me neither. Wow, they got bad motives. I'm discerning there's something wrong in that situation. Paul's like, yep, I discern that same thing. But I rejoice because the gospel is preached and God will worry about those things. And I think that's part of the thing of letting go and coming back to the very end of the message, because this is beautiful. This was really encouraging to me. When I saw this is, there were a lot of people, and we know this with the other gospels too, that rejected them at the testimony. They rejected what John was testifying about. But then it also says in verse 37, the two disciples who heard him say this, follow Jesus. Verse 40, Andrew, Simon, Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard and they followed him. And the truth is there'll be many that reject, but there'll be some that follow. And the truth is, would we be willing to risk looking foolish to 20 if one follows? Are we willing to risk like the fact that I'm even hesitant to say this because it's weird and it's it seems unlogical and it seems unexplainable and you may think I'm an idiot when I'm done, but you might also see Jesus because I'm trying to tell you about Jesus. And yes, to the rest of the world, he looks foolish. So expect it. Expect to look foolish, but know someone to follow. So we'll follow.
Well, when we start thinking about how we look and we start thinking about the numbers, now we're evaluating on the world's terms.
We're not really
looking at it through spiritual eyes. It's not really about the successes and the failures. It's about, are we going to make a commitment to, as you just read, to follow and just, you know,
I
said earlier, you know, about, you know, I think of Paul oftentimes when I was reading this passage, I think of Paul, you know, in a couple of instances, one of them was Paul says, I am being poured out. I am already being poured out like a drink. Well, I think John knew that about himself too. This is what I have to do. Paul said, this is what I have to, woe to me if I don't do this. This is what I'm called to do. What are we called to do? And, you know, I mean, I think I'm like a lot of people. I think I wrestle with that. What am I called to do? And can I move forward and do that with confidence? And I admittedly, there is a lot of years of my faith that were really stagnant. They were really static. They didn't move.
And yet, I think what you're speaking to, which is one of the things I really wanted people to see at the very end of this message, is you're speaking to God's grace. Because in our brokenness, we're afraid. In our brokenness, we may even not speak and regret, why didn't I say something then? And what God's grace is he recognizes our brokenness. I think of the end of the story, and I'm going to say in the message, Grow Group leaders talk about this. So verses 47 through 51 is when Jesus comes and he's coming to one of them, and he's very skeptical. He's like, they're like, hey, I think we found the Messiah, and come and see. And then and he's like, maybe. He's like, is Nathaniel, and he said, can anything really good come out of Nazareth? Like, he's like, I mean, seriously? And Jesus says to him, and he comes to him and he says, here truly is an Israelite of whom there is no deceit. So even when this dude was questioning Jesus, Jesus compliments him, right? He encourages him. And then he's like, well, how do you know me? He says, well, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. And what I see is that, you know what Jesus did? He gave him a little sign. He's like, guess what, buddy? Let me tell you a little prophetic word here from the Messiah that I saw you and now you just heard that. And there was a beautiful sign that in Nathaniel's brokenness that he didn't want to, he was doubtful. He was skeptical of the supernatural. He was skeptical of even that this that could really be happening. And Jesus is like, well, let me show you a little bit. And he gives him a little taste. And then I love how it ends. And it says, Jesus says, do you believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree? And he says, you're going to see even greater things than this. I get goosebumps as I say that because as a church, if there's something that we as we go through the book of John, be excited that we will get to see even greater things than this. Mm-hmm. We are going to see God show himself to us, mm-hmm. show us Jesus, see the signs of what Jesus did, but no, they don't end in John. Mm-hmm. Right. They continue in our lives, and we get to be testimonies of even greater things and to be that testimony. If grow groups could even begin to just talk about what that's going to look like mm-hmm. and even anticipate that, I would be excited about that. So,
and I think even for us this week, David, as we have had two people come in specifically that have asked to be baptized and connecting their stories, we have seen God doing greater things even this week here at Bethany. And that's just been such a hug.
That is good.
Yeah, such a hug for me, just as we've transitioned and there's been sadness, and it's like God is still moving at Bethany, and it's super exciting. So, well, with that being said, we probably need to end. I loved having you here, Bill.
Thank you.
We want to see more of Bill's face. So
I'm going to make sure we invite Bill back more. So I'm saying that publicly, so now he knows he got the invitation and can't say no.
There you go. So thank you. Have a great weekend. Bye-bye.